Right, so here's a new unit. We started periodic functions, unit G. Things that repeat themselves, things that have a cycle, things that have a period, things that have patterns. Yeah, I think you'll like this unit. We'll do some bungee jumping. So you've studied lots of different kinds of functions. You've done lines, right? That's slopes of roofs and relationship between you and your sister's ages and maybe your bank account. You've done quadratics, optimizing profits and things flying through the air and trajectories. We did the lines in grade 10, the quadratics in grade 11. We did cubics when we were looking at volumes and a few other things. We've looked at other kinds of functions too. Don't forget we did these exponentials. How mold grows in your bathtub or how your coffee cools. Remember how we solved all these things? Usually graphically on the graphing calculator. And this is how your money grows as well. Well, now we're studying a new kind of function. We're studying the sinusoidal, well, the periodic function. We're studying the sine curve, in other words. Waves. So what are the things do you know that are periodic? How about seasons? Don't they repeat themselves every 12 months? How about the temperature, the seasonal temperature? Gee, it seems to me it gets hot in July and cold in January. And it seems to repeat that pattern over and over in the tides. I showed you some tides down in the Minas Basin there where I grew up. Heartbeat. Anything that has a repeating pattern to it. The amount of sunlight you get on any particular day of the year. Now, when we measure angles, though, in this unit, we measure from the x-axis and we go counterclockwise. We don't do it the navigator method like we did in vectors. So we don't start at north and then measure clockwise to the right. We start on the x-axis and we measure up. Okay. So it's sort of backwards from what we're used to doing with vectors and navigation and bearings. But that's just the way it is. Okay, so we got you to graph a couple typical angles. 180 degrees, 90 degrees, 240 degrees. Hey, you can go 400 degrees. It just means you went 40 past once around. It means you went once around and a bit. 540 is 360 plus another 180. In other words, you went 1.5 times around. You can have negative angles, negative 60. Instead of going clockwise, correction, counterclockwise, you go clockwise. And negative 240. Right, so you can have negative angles, you can have angles more than 360. Just depends on which direction you want to go around the circle or how far. And then we are looking at this unit circle, right? You'll get familiar with this unit circle. We call it a unit circle because it's a circle on some grid paper there, right? Centered on the origin. And it only goes up to one to the right, and one up, and negative one to the left, and negative one down. And it's a handy way to picture your sines and cosines. So I asked you there, I got you to draw a nice 30-degree angle with a protractor. You did it accurately. And then you pretended you were on the end of that purple line there, and we measured how high up you were if you're going around on that circle. So you're on the circumference of the circle, you're 30 degrees up on a Ferris wheel, say, and you counted 0.1, 0.2, 0.3, 0.5 up. Neat. And then I got you to take sine of 30 on your calculator, and it said it was 0.5. And then I got you to do sine of 90 and graphed it accurately, the protractor. And how high up are you when you're at 90 degrees? Well, you're all the way up. You're one up. And that's called the sine of 90, sure enough. You do the sine of 90 on a plastic brain, it'll tell you you're one up. Sine of 120. Well, we graphed it accurately, and you counted up, and you went 0.1, 0.2. You got up to about 0.87, we sort of agreed. Well, the calculator will tell you that it's 0.866. So you can actually start to picture the sine of an angle in your head just by pretending you're on a Ferris wheel. What's the sine of 345 degrees? Yep, we accurately drew it. 345, well, 15 short of a full circle. And when you count down, what do I get there? I get about 0.1, 0.2. So if you're on that Ferris wheel and you're on the circle on the end of that arm, looks like about 0.26 to me just by reading it off the graph. And sure enough, that's what the plastic brain will tell you. Negative 0.26, though. So here's another one. The sine of negative 150 degrees. The sine of negative 150 degrees. Well, if you accurately draw it in, looks like about, looks like about 0.5 down. So negative 0.5, because it's 0.5 below the hub of the Ferris wheel, or the origin of the circle. Yep. And the plastic brain will tell you the same thing. Negative 0.5. You can actually get pretty good at calculating sines and in your head just by using this unit circle, and you'll be pretty close too. You'd take a bit of practice. All right, so let's plot the sine. And so what we did was I just got you to calculate using your cheat sheet, or using your plastic brain rather, for a whole bunch of different angles. You calculated the sine, although technically you could sort of read them off that unit circle that we were just playing with, and you'll get pretty much the sufficiently accurate answer. So here come your numbers for your table, and let's plot those numbers. All right, here come the plots, the points from the table. Then we'll connect the dots. There you go. Makes interesting little wave. We call it the sine curve. Graphing the sine function. And you'll find that, you know how we used ax squared plus bx plus c for quadratics? You'll find that we're using an extra letter now in sinusoidal functions. We use a times the sine of bx plus c, well, all of bx plus c, plus d. And you'll learn what each of these does. It's not tough. And we started by graphing a few of these, right? I just gave you a couple to graph. Put them in your graphing calculator, on your plastic brain, or they work too on the internet. There's lots of graphing tools on the net that do this too. All right, and when we graphed y equals sine x, like the plain Jane simple function, there's what we got, the pretty little window there. Make sure you hit zoom number 7, though, trig, so that you're counting your tick marks are at 90 instead of every one. Otherwise, you'll just get a sort of a flat-looking line. And here's just another unit circle in case you want to have some fun with that. Periodic functions. Page 14 in our notes. Right, we're studying equations like that. Y equals 4 times the sine of 2 x's. And then add 4. And don't forget, we got a final exam the 29th. Here's a sample application from our notes. So here's Don at the Red River Exhibition. He's on the Ferris wheel. He wants to check to see if his buddies come in the gate. We're going to graph that equation. And we're going to do some calculations. Just like we're asking for here. Here's the type of questions you get. And disregard question G there for, well, disregard it. The phase shift isn't all that important usually, unless you're doing electronic warfare or something. Okay, there's Don going around the Ferris wheel. There's the entrance over there on the right. There's some buildings blocking Don's view, so, you know, he can only see his friends when he's at a certain height on the Ferris wheel. Here's the equation of his motion around the Ferris wheel. He's repeating his pattern over and over. It's called going around the circle. So, you'll never be wrong by doing a table. If you want to graph something, do a table. pick some numbers, plug them into the recipe, calculate them, spit out the other thing. So pick a time, smash it into the recipe, well, the formula, and calculate the height. But you know what? Often it's pretty easy to do in your head if you pick sensible numbers, because I'm really good at taking the sine of 0, and I'm really good at taking the sine of 180, and I'm pretty good at taking the sine of 270 and negative 90. And so if you make some sensible choices for your unknown t, it's pretty easy to calculate in your head your h. But if you want to use your calculator, go for it. But the table that I just generated on the left is more than sufficient. Just generate numbers that you can do in your, you know, pick t's that when you plug them in, you'll be able to do in your head. You don't need a plastic brain to do this stuff. And when you graph it, it'll look something like this. There, I just copied the table that we did in our head using sensible numbers. There you go. So there's Don starting at time 0. He's going up, up, up. He reaches the peak. At 1 minute, he comes down, 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 and he reaches the bottom again in 2 minutes. Guess where he's going after that? I'll bet you he's going to go back up again. Yep. And your plastic brain will tell you the formula is, well, here it comes. Height equals 30 times the sine of 180 times t minus 90, and then add 32. And you could generate some more values of t. And obviously Don can go around and around. Hopefully it's not a Ferris wheel that goes around just once. Probably goes around a few times. So of course there'll be another cycle that comes into play here. There he goes on another cycle. Same pattern over another cycle. Here's cycle number 3. And let's connect the dots. Gee, looks like he's going on a sinusoidal curve. And we call any repeating pattern a cycle. And it doesn't matter what you call the cycle, as long as it's a repeating part. We could have called it, instead of going from peak to peak there, we could have gone from bottom to bottom if we wanted. As long as it's a cycle, is just the repeating pattern. And you might decide to go from bottom to bottom instead of top to top. It doesn't really matter, as long as it repeats. So notice that we can actually measure the time between peaks. Well, the time between peaks, or the time it takes to repeat is 2 minutes in this case. And here we are. We're going to see when is he below 20 meters, because that's when he can't see his buddies coming in the gate. So we want to calculate those two red dots, and we'll just do them on the first cycle there on the left, because there's an infinite number of times where he won't be able to see his buddies if he goes around the wheel forever. But we're just interested in the first couple instances. All right, so you can use your calculator to do that. That's the old second trace calculate number 5 intersect or something like that. We've been doing that since grade 10 when we were doing lines and things like that. All right, so there's what you put in your calculator or your graphing tool. There are websites that do all this too. You type in things and they graph them for you. But we're doing it on the TI-83. And there's what we ended up when we did it on the TI-83. And we were looking for those two points there. Second calculate intersect. Turns out that it was at 0.37 minutes and 1.63 minutes. So at 0.37, we care about the difference between the two. So there's 1.26 minutes where he's above 20 meters. So it's like a minute and a half. 1.26, it's 1 1/4. About a minute 15, right? 1 26 1/100ths of a minute is about 1 15 60ths. So 1 minute and 15 seconds that he's above 20 meters. So it sounds like there's about 45 seconds where he's below 20 meters. So 45 seconds, or 0.74 minutes. So 0.74 minutes out of every 2 minutes, he'll be hidden from his buddies coming in the gate. So there's a good chance they'll miss him. Okay, so there you go. 37% chance he's going to miss his buddies. And like I was saying, you do have lots of graphing tools online. There. There's just an example of an equation that I typed in for you. I got about I got 5 or 6 graphing tools online that you can use. So here we go. What was Don's max height and all that? We're still on here with Don, going around the Ferris wheel. Well, you got a button on your calculator finds maxes. It's called second, trace, select number 4, maximum. And it'll tell you that Don was at a maximum. You could find that maximum hump there at, well, our calculator, when we did it, said 0.9999999. I'm pretty sure it's trying to tell you it's 1 second. So at 1 second, he was 62 meters up. Ooh. And what is his min? Well, you use the same button on the calculator, the same process, and it turns out the min's going to be 2 meters at 2 minutes. So the plastic brain will tell you all that, hitting second trace maximum or second trace minimum. And let's look at the formula that we calculated, the formula that we were given. Remember that that 32 at the end is called a median. That's the average. That's the height of the middle of the wave. It's pretty much where the hub of the Ferris wheel is. And the 30 is the amplitude. So you go 30 above 32, and 30 below 32, 30 above 32, 30 below 32. So you can actually see where your max and your min are just from that formula. What's 30 plus 32? There you go, 62. What's your minimum? Well, it's 32, take away the 30, down to 2. So just by looking at the formula, you can actually see what's going on once you practice with this stuff a little more. And how high are you at a certain time? Well, all you do is plug into that recipe. You had a formula that says, here's how high you are for any particular T. Plug in the number and see what comes out. Right. My 4-year-old grandson does this. Plugging in a number and getting the plastic brain to give you the answers. Not that tough. It's when you got to jiggle it around and do some algebra that, well, yeah, that takes a bit more thinking. This is all just plug in. And the plastic brain will tell you that too, using second trace value. If you're on the graphing mode, you just type second trace value and it'll say, well, tell me what the X is you want. You type in 1.2 and the little spider goes pink, goes right to the curve and tells you what the answer is. And you can then type in another number, 5 or 7 or 12 or whatever. And it will, spider will move on the graph and go, here you are. This is where you would be at 1.2 minutes or 2 minutes or whatever number of minutes. It's not that tough just to do on a regular calculator, though. Just plunk the number in, plug it in. And actually, you can probably estimate them pretty well in your head, right? I've taught you how to estimate sines and cosines in your head. All right, so I sort of got to repeat some lessons here because people wander in and out. So this is back in the notes, way more towards the front. Just for those who missed what the heck a sine X looks like, you going around the Ferris wheel, if you were to graph the angle you're at versus the height you're at, there's what it looks like on the graph. Here's another example. Now we're going to put a 3 in front of the sine X. Ooh, wonder what that does. Now, I always like to put the sine X all by itself. So that black line there, curve rather, is the sine X. Now, putting the 3 in front just amplifies it, makes it bigger. Let's have a look at what happens when you put a 2 in front of the X. So you put a number, like a B, in front of the X before you do the sine. What that's going to do is it's going to squish the graph. It's going to be a higher frequency. Instead of being like this, it's going to be like this. Yeah, you could just, you can always graph things by picking numbers that are easy to do in your head. Or use the graph, or use any $2 calculator. But I decided to graph it. I decided to make a table here just to show you that it's easy to do. I picked numbers that I could do in my head. I picked zero. I'm very good taking 2 times 0. And 2 times 0 is 0, and the sine of 0 is 0. I know that. I hope you know it too from looking at your unit circle diagram on the right there. And then I picked 45. Because I know that 2 times 45 is a nice easy number I can do in my head. Sine of 245, so the sine of 90 is 1. I can do that in my head. Then I tried 90. 2 times 90 is 180. I can do the sine of 180 in my head. That's 0. So you can pretty much come up with your own table if you want. You don't really need a plastic brain to do this. And there's what it looks like. The blue curve is the 2x, the sine of 2x curve. And the black curve is your regular plain Jane sine of x curve. So notice the 2 in the second, in the blue curve there. The 2x, the 2 tells you how many cycles there are in 360. So it just means it's going to happen twice as often. It affects the period, it affects the frequency, it's all sort of the same word. We could get more specific later. Check out your notes on all that. And more warm up here. Oh, this is the next day. Yeah, I ask you to graph plain Jane y equals sine x, and I ask you to graph y equals 3 times the sine of 2x plus 3. And you don't really even need a table for this. If you want to do the second equation there, the median is 3. So you know it bounces around the middle of 3. The amplitude is 3. So you know it bounces 3 above 3 and 3 below 3. So you know it bounces between 0 and 6. And the 2 means you're going to squeeze in 2 cycles in what normally takes 360 degrees. Didn't even really need a table like this. This is like that y equals mx plus b stuff where you got the slope and the intercept and you go boom, boom and draw the line and you're good to go. It's exactly the same thing here. You can actually see the pattern from the equation. But if you want to use the plastic brain to do it, you're allowed. There you go. There's what it looks like. But you are technically allowed to use the plastic graphing tool to do this stuff. But if you're stuck on a desert island without your graphing calculator, how would you do this stuff? Oh my goodness. And don't forget to always go zoom number 7 trig, and it will usually pick the perfect window. All right, so let's solve an equation using graphing. All right, this could be like Don going around the Ferris wheel or whatever, a tsunami coming into shore or something. Anything that's got a period or a wave to it. So there I'm asking you, when does 3 times the sine of 2x, then add 3, equal 4.5? Well, plastic brain, type it in on your calculator and it'll graph the pretty picture for you. And you type in the y equals 4.5 line, so you're typing in two different curves there. You're typing in the left-hand curve, 3 sine of 2x plus 3. And you're typing in y equals 4.5. So you're typing in the left side in y1 and the right side in y2, and you're just finding where the two curves, well, one of them's line, but the two curves cross each other. And your plastic brain will tell you that it's at 15 degrees and at 75 degrees. And of course, 195 and, you know, every 180 degrees after that too, because it does have a repeating pattern. There are an infinite number of answers. But normally we're only concerned about the first two, because I don't like an infinite number of answers on a piece of paper. It takes too long to mark them. Now, how would you do it using algebra? And again, technically, in applied math, You do not need to know how to do it using algebra. You are allowed to use machines and tools in applied math to get your answers. But let's have a look at how you do it using algebra. It's not a heck of a lot harder. If you know how to do something simple like 2x plus 1 equals 7, there might be one extra step in here. So using algebra, you want to get the x by itself. Seems to me like it's cold solving. So you want to undo whatever's done to it to get it by itself. So you're going to take away 3 off both sides. You're going to inverse sine it to undo the sine. So if you inverse sine, you find out the answer is 30 degrees. So 2x's is 30 degrees. So if 2x's is 30 degrees, 1x is 15 degrees. There you go. But your plastic brain is kind of stupid. It doesn't realize that there's another answer. So it came up with 2x's is 30 degrees, but you also know there's another place where your sine is 0.5, and that's 150 degrees. And half of 150 is 75. So your plastic brain only tells you one of the answers. That's why you have a brain, because you can figure out the other answer or answers. There's how you do it using regular everyday algebra. Check it out. Again, you only have to know how to do it with a graph and a graphing tool. You don't have to know how to do the algebra method. Well, this is fun. We're going to put somebody on a water wheel and spin them around and glub, glub, glub and all that fun stuff. Okay, so there they are on the water wheel, and we're going to make them go around and around and around. Don't try that with your friends. And that was actually an assignment. So there she is. She's on the water wheel. The water wheel has a radius of 2.7. And the hub of the wheel is 1.5 meters above the water. And the equation, I tell you, even though you could figure out some of it yourself, is the height of her head is 2.7 times the sine of 5 times t, and then add 1.5. And that will tell you where her head is at any particular time. You give me a time, I'll tell you where her head is. Let's do a table. When the time is 0, 5 times 0 is 0, sine of 0, 0, 0 times 2.7, 0 plus 1.5 is 1.5. Gotta love those zeros. Okay? So you can do the table there on the left by plugging in numbers. Now that 5 is pretty much telling you that it takes 72 seconds to go around the circle. Because remember how the 5 tells you the period? That tells you how many cycles are happening in 360. So if 5 things are happening in 360 seconds, well then there must be 72 seconds for each thing. That's why you divide that B letter, that letter in with the X or the T, you divide it into 360 to find out what the period is. That's all on your cheat sheet. Reference notes, I mean. And here we are, we're continuing the table. I'm just picking convenient numbers that I can do in my head. All right. You can pick whatever numbers you want for T and use a calculator, but I tend to like to just do them in my head and pick numbers that I can work out nice, easy to calculate numbers. So there you go. At 54 seconds, glub, glub, glub. What's the value? And okay, here's the questions that we had. There you go. I'm just filling in. You can just watch this. It's a 72 second period. In other words, 72 seconds to do one cycle. 360 divided by 5 is 72. And then we graphed it here. We got a little bit fancier and we graphed it here on graph paper instead of just the plastic brain. So we calculated, when does her head go under the water? Well, you can sort of eyeball it there. It looks to me like it's about, well, if that's 36 seconds there, 72 for a whole cycle, 36 for half a cycle, and you can see that first black circle there, that's going to be, I don't know, 40 seconds? Well, the calculator actually tells you it's 42.75. And what's the distance between the two black circles, like when her head goes under and when her head comes back up? Well, if you subtract the two answers, it turns out to be about 22 and a half seconds. So she's got to hold her breath for 22 and a half seconds. All right, now we get into the good stuff. How many radii are there around the circumference of a circle? So I issued all three of us a circle, a nice round circle, and I got you to measure. I got you to make a little ruler that was R long, and you stretched it and put it around the edge of your circumference of your circle, and we counted how many R's, how many radii there are around the circumference of a circle. And we all pretty much agreed there's six and a bit. And we weren't getting too fancy, but there's about six and a bit radii going around a circle. Well, if you were to get an arc that is the length of one radius around the edge of a circle, if you were to get your aunt to cut you a piece of cake, for example, round cake, where the crust or the edge, the arc was the same length as the radius of the cake, you would have one radian angle. There you go. There's what a radian is. A radian is the central angle that you subtend by, that is subtended by going around an arc a distance of one radius. So if you follow what all this says, it pretty much says that that's called a radian. And a radian happens to be about 57 degrees. Most people just say it's about 60. How many radians are in a circle? Well, you know that a circle, the total circumference of a circle is 2 pi radii. So if I say how many radii are in something, if you're saying how many can you take out of it, that's called dividing. So C divided by R would be 2 pi R divided by R. So it turns out that the number of radii in a circle is not 6 and a bit, but 2 pi. Exactly. Which happens to be about 6.28-ish. Now 6.28 is like 6 and a bit. So it turns out that 2 pi equals 360, and therefore 1 pi radian. And you don't need that little r there. Technically, it's not correct to do that. But 1 pi radian is the same as 180 degrees. So you know there's 12 inches in a foot. Well, now you know there's pi radians and 180 degrees. It's just a conversion factor, just like dollars to pesos, or feet to inches, or miles to kilometers. We're now just converting angles. Let's practice this conversion. 30 degrees is pi divided by 6 radians. And if you insist on converting it to decimal radians, it'd be 0.5236. But why would you do that when it's exactly pi divided by 6? All right, except that computers need to use decimal radians, of course. So you will see decimal radians when you're working with computers. 45 degrees is pi divided by 4. Yeah, you got to be pretty good at using, at, you know, 9 over 36. You got to know that 9 over 36 is the same as 1 over 4. And if you don't like reducing fractions like that, check out the, chances are there's a button on your calculator that does it. There is on our TI-83, a button that converts fractions into their reduced form. All right, so I show you what it is up on the top right there. We've done it before. And any calculator that's worth more than about $5 probably has a ABC button on that converts fractions to. There's more practices here, converting degrees into radians. And I sometimes like to just picture the thing in my head, right? You don't really need a computation to do this. Isn't 60 degrees? Well, here's 90 degrees. Well, we already agreed that pi radians is halfway around the circle. So isn't 90 degrees a quarter of the way around the circle? Isn't that going to be half of pi? Do you really need a calculation to do that? Or can you sort of see that 90 degrees is the same as a quarter of a way around a circle? Or halfway around a semicircle? Yeah, try to picture these in your head. Now, somebody said that, yeah, they did the math and they calculated that the 120 was pi divided by 1.5, which technically is not wrong. But isn't 1.5 really 3 halves? So if you're dividing by 3 halves, that's really the same as multiplying by 2 thirds. So, you know, a little smarter looking answer is 2 thirds of a pi. Now we're going to convert from degrees back to radians. So we're still doing the same thing there, 270 degrees. I'm just trying to show you can picture them in your head. Just picture a circle there, you going around a circle, but instead of 90 and 180, you're picturing pies and halves of pies and quarters of pies. And, ooh, you can do 400 degrees. It just means you went around the circle once and another 40 on top of it. And now you get some pretty funky looking numbers, 20 pi's divided by 9. That's just crazy. Okay, let's make sure you know how to do these on your calculator. What's the sine of 30? There you go, 0.5. Then I asked you, what's the sine of pi divided by 6? Well, 30 degrees is the same as pi divided by 6 radians, but you gotta tell your calculator that you're working in radians. You gotta find your DRG button, or your mode button, or whatever it is that tells your calculator to work in degrees, or in radians. And you get the exact same answer. So the sine of pi divided by 6 on any calculator will tell you it's 0.5, provided you're telling the calculator that you're working in radians. So make sure that little DEG or that little RAD thing on your calculator is in the proper units. Otherwise, you'll confuse your computer. And don't worry about the G. The G is gradients. The French, like 100 years ago, tried to put 100 degrees in a square corner instead of 90. They tried to metricize it or something. So you'll never use gradients unless you're an engineer or a surveyor or something. And here's just some more off of our worksheet that we're working on. And just remember that a radian, you know, if you want a picture of what a radian is on a circle or an angle, it's about 60 degrees, 57.3, but about 60. If you ever really want a picture of what one radian is, 60 degrees is pretty close. That's what they teach you when you're sailing or flying. Lots and lots of angles when you're sailing and flying, I'll tell you. And here we got Gulf 2, the assignment. Yeah, I like to throw in some astronomy there too. Follow the arc to Arcturus and speed on to Spica. There's my favorite planet there, Mizar and Alcor. You can actually check your eyesight. Follow the arc to Arcturus and speed on to Spica. There's my favorite planet there, Mizar and Alcor. You can actually check your eyesight with those. In any event, we were trying to find out what 60 degrees was. Yeah, that was just fun. And I think we started a new day here. We're going to see what this equation y equals 2 times the sine of x plus 3 looks like. So you could do a table, pick some convenient numbers that you can sine in your head. I can sine 0 pretty easy in my head. I can sine 90 in my head. I can sine 180 and 270 and 360 in my head. And then, so you plug into that recipe there. But you know what it looks like, I hope. You know that 3 is the average or the median. That's the D at the end of the equation. So everything bounces around that. The 2 is the amplitude. So it goes up to 5, down to 1. Up to 5, down to 1. It's not tough. Or just plug it into a table if you don't know what to do. Pick convenient numbers, though. Or technically, you're allowed to just smash it into the calculator and let it graph it, though. So if you didn't want to use a table, if you just wanted to look at the equation and go, oh, I can graph it and do it without having to do the table, which isn't that tough to do either. Remember how the 3 is the median. It is the average height. So it's the middle, horizontal middle of the curve. So the curve bounces around that 3. The 2 is the amplitude. So you know this wave bounces 2 above 3, which would be 5, and 2 below 3, which would be 1. So you got a maximum of 5 and a minimum of 1. And there's a hidden 1 in front of the X, and that tells you how many cycles there are, how many cycles squeeze into 360 degrees. Well, there's going to be one cycle every 360 degrees in this case. So you know to put a start at the front there, and it finishes 360 degrees later. And halfway in between at 180, it's got to come back down through. And then halfway between the center and the far left, it's got to reach its peak. And then 3/4 of the way, so in other words, halfway through the last part of the cycle there, it's got to reach a minimum. And we already discussed where the max is and the min is. It's pretty easy just to plot the points. And you didn't even really need a table. But again, you're allowed to actually just use the plastic brain to graph it for you if you don't like doing this. So if you can solve those, well, there's only like one extra step to solving something like this. When does 2 times the sine of an angle, I didn't put the angle in there, plus 3 equal 5? So right after sin there, there should be a x or something. Well, you can picture yourself going around the Ferris wheel. Oh, there's my x. You know that it has a average of 3. The function has an average of 3, and it bounces 2 up and 2 below. So it goes up to 5, down to 1, up to 5, down to 1. And I'm saying, well, when does it reach 5? Well, can you picture yourself on the Ferris wheel? You can pretty much do this one on the back of a cigarette pack, you know, if you practice enough. Looks like it happens at exactly 90 degrees. And if you use a graphing tool, it'll tell you the same thing too. Alright, let's go back to converting some angles here. And sometimes you end up with decimal radians. There's nothing wrong with a decimal radian. I prefer to have exact things like with pies in them. But you can end up with decimal radians sometimes. Yeah, here we're counting how many radiuses go around the circle again. I think this is the third time I've done this lesson. Not sure why I keep doing the same thing three different times. Oh yeah, here we go again. I'll just let this run real quick. This will be like the third time I've explained what a radian is. we'll just let this run. And it does help if you can see these in your head. If you know that halfway around the circle is pi radians, it's pretty easy to figure out what pi divided by 2 radians is. Okay, so it looks like this is Thursday. Yeah, got the quiz today. Yeah, that diagram goes with the quiz, if you needed help setting up the diagram, although you shouldn't. And then we did the quiz, and then we learned the very last lesson here. Remember how your money grew in grade 11? Remember we had data like that, at 0 years it was 7,000, after 1 year it was 7,130 or something, and then we plotted dots and it grew like that. It was called exponential growth. And we stuck things in list one, and we stuck things in list two, and we hit second, correction, we hit stat calculate something or other, and we calculated things. Well, we're going to do the exact same thing, but with sine curves. So here we go. Assignment G3. We give you the temperatures in Winnipeg. And these are the actual temperatures for the last over 100 years, right? This is about 140 years worth of temperatures. And they keep track of the average monthly temperature and the average maximum temperature. So like, what is that? Usually 4 o'clock in the afternoon type thing. And the average minimum temperature for the month. So that's usually the 2 in the morning. And usually there's a 10 degree range. You know that from experience, 10, 12 degrees difference. And then they average the averages and call that the mean temperature. So what we're doing on this one is we're looking at the pattern by month. So the bottom horizontal axis there, the x-axis, is your month number. And your mean temperature, let's do the mean temperature, the average temperature for the entire month. And we'll plot that. And we put it in our graphing calculator. We put all those data in there in list one and list two. So the first column, the month number, goes in list one, and the mean temperature, the far right column, goes in list two. And it tells us what the equation is. Well, you know that the pattern's going to repeat. Every January it gets cold, and every July it gets hot. It's kind of like a repeating pattern. It turns out the answer is, well, there's the equation, 19.49 times the sine of 0.466x minus 1.72 plus 0.53. The scary part about that is, look at that 0.53 at the end. That is the average temperature for Winnipeg. If you had to tell somebody what the average temperature for Winnipeg was, like for an entire year, the average, if you had to pick one temperature to represent the average for Winnipeg, for like the average temperature, it's going to be half a degree above zero. That's our average temperature in Winnipeg, half a degree above zero. Now, it bounces around either side of that, of course. It bounces 20 above or 25 above in the summer and 25 below that in the winter. But the average temperature in Winnipeg is half a degree above zero. Oh well, at least there's no poison snakes. And when I do these converting, sometimes I like to draw the picture of them. It makes it in my head a little more obvious what's going on here. If you're not sketching things out when you're doing math, like on a little bit of scrap paper, you're probably not doing math right. There's more to math than just a whack of numbers. Okay, and this is in the notes. We got a beam that's vibrating. Right? And you've noticed the building vibrate every time a train wanders by. Everything vibrates. Everything follows this formula. A times the sine of B times X plus C, and then add D at the end. Everything vibrates. Everything has a period when it vibrates. and an amplitude and a frequency. It's not just beams. So by looking at this, I mean, when we did the notes, I tried to get you to look at the data and come up with what the answers are. You don't really need a plastic brain to tell you all this, because what is the period there? Seems to me that at zero, it's at 3 centimeters, and at 8, it's at 3 centimeters again. And notice at 4, it was at 3. So it started at 3, it went back down through 3, and it came back up to 3 in 8 seconds. So it went up, 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 down, 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 back through 3. Then down, 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 then back up to 3. Looks to me from the data that the pattern repeats every 8 seconds, doesn't it? And what's the period? Well, that's the period, 8 seconds. And what is the maximum? Well, it looks to me like the max is about 5. And it looks to me like the minimum's, well, it looks to me like it's about 1. So if the maximum is 5 and the minimum is 1, what's the average? What's the median halfway? Well, how do you find your average median Merck? You take 5 and add 1 and divide by 2. So it's 3. So midway between 5 and 1 is 3. So I'm thinking the average or the median is 3. So the D is 3. And the A, well, the amplitude, well, we know the median is 3. And we know it goes up to 5 and down to 1. Sounds like the amplitude's 2. So the A is a 2. The D, we figured, is a 3. The B is your period. That's how many times a cycle fits into 360 degrees, or 2 pi radians. So 2 pi divided by 8 is 0.785. I mean, I'm just predicting the equation. I'm not going to worry about the C, because that's a phase shift. That just means that you started timing at a different place, maybe. I'm going to say the equation is going to look something like H is 2 times the sine of 0.785 plus E3. I'm betting the equation looks like that. I didn't
and
the
here's the
question we had on our practice test.
The plastic you're all out of practice test.
So yes, let's see what the plastic brain tells us. I'm just going to take to graph that. The time in list 1, the distance in list 2.
You had to calculate the period, the time to, well, that's the period time to do
but
one.
If you understand what we've been doing so far with the graphing, you really can
question some of these equations in your head.
It's on the practice
maybe
test.
Without the phase shift.
So you're going to plug in the stats edit. You're going to clear your lists. Just check out your reference notes. You're going to turn on your plots. You're going to graph your stats. Don't forget to hit zoom number 9 stats, and then it'll find the perfect window to plot all your dots. Then the dots come popping up, and then you hit stat calculate sinusoidal regression number 0 way down at the bottom off the screen. And look at what it tells you. Isn't that what I suggested the answer was going to be? Just by looking at the information? Look at that. I think I came up with the exact same formula, didn't I? Well, you could have too. And there's what the dots should have looked like. I just did it in Excel. Excel does a very good job of plotting dots, by the way. You watch me do this. It took like 10 seconds to do this. All right, so there's the graph. Oh, this was the graph for temperature. I'm sorry. This was the graph for the temperature in Winnipeg. And we were actually graphing the maximum temperature. Ooh. The maximum temperature in Winnipeg is given by that equation, 20 times the sine of 0.475x minus 1.3 plus 6.5. In other words, the average high temperature, if you were to average all the high temperatures every day at 4 in the afternoon type thing, every day and average them all out, winter and summer and spring and fall, the average would be 6.5 degrees for the high temperature. Now, obviously, it swings 20 above and 20 below, depending on the season. And here's the question we had on our practice test. You all had a practice test. We asked you for the window, and I just wanted you to graph that. You had to calculate the period and the time to, well, that's the time to do one cycle. The question asked you for the amplitude. It's on the practice test.
I got lots of them. Yeah, this is on the practice test, too. Well, I'm sorry, this is on our quiz review, because we had that quiz, and now we're just giving you the answers after I marked it. Yeah, we're getting to the point now, if you start missing quizzes, you know, I don't have time to make more quizzes. You'll just have to accept a nothing. Square root of zero. Yep, so this is pretty self-explanatory. Looks kind of good when you animate it. And of course, you're allowed to do it on the plastic brain, the graphing tool, the TI-83, or an 86 if you got the bucks. I think they got an 89 out or something now. So it's just like regular everyday. If you wanted to do it using algebra, you could have done it using algebra. You didn't have to graph it. Algebra is not that tough. All you do is undo things. The only extra step in here, if you understood how to do 2x minus 1 equals 7, well then this was no different. The only other step is you had to unsign it. So you had to know how to use an inverse sign. But technically, you only need to know how to use the graphing tool to do this stuff. But I do like to show you the algebra way to do stuff too. Come in. Yeah, this is the one where I said you could sort of do it in your head. You didn't really need a calculator. You can actually calculate the period. You can calculate the max and the min. You can actually see the average in the data. It won't always be this easy, of course. I arranged it so it would look easy. So I was pretty much saying I could calculate the equation without a machine to tell me what it was. And then we said, well, let's see what the machine says. So you're allowed to let the machine tell you what the answer is. But it is possible to figure out amplitudes and periods and maxes and mins sometimes, by just looking at the information. Forget zoom number 9 stats. This is doing a regression. Here comes the equation. Gee, looks remarkably like the one that I did without a computer. And again, this is the daily high temperatures in Winnipeg. We calculated a regression equation from that on the assignment. So I did this twice for people too. So the average high temperature in Winnipeg is 6.5. And this was on the practice test that I handed out that you can work on the weekend. Well, except you don't have a graphing tool. Well, you got the online ones though. So this is on the practice test, and this pretty much completes all the notes. And loving it. 3 more weeks to go. Just a little hint. Okay, let's graph this equation here. Well, correction, this is a function. It's not an equation unless we try to make the y equal to something in particular. Obviously, this is in radians, because you do not see anywhere in that formula the degree symbol. So if you don't see the degree symbol, the thing is in radians. Right, so we'll make the x-axis, the theta axis, the radians axis. So one radian, 2 radians, 3 radians, 4. And you know a radian's about 60 degrees, so you can sort of picture what's going on there. Let's make the axis. Let's do what we always do when we're graphing. Let's do a table. All right, What is zero? Well, zero, if you plug zero in, zero times the two, is going to be two zeros. And the sign of zero is zero, I hope you know in your head. Three times zero is zero, take away two, you get negative two. How about when the angle's pi divided by four? Well, two pi's divided by four would be pi divided by two, and the sine of pi by two, which is really 90 degrees, I hope you know that's one in your head, times three would be three, take away two is one. How about pi divided by two? Pi divided by two, if that was the angle, that'd be two halves of a pi, a whole pi, the sine of a whole pi is zero, three zeros are enough, back to negative two. So you could just do your own table there. And just pick numbers that are convenient that you can sort of do in your head. Or plug them into a calculator if you want. Or heck, you're even allowed just to smash the equation in and just read from the table in the calculator if you wanted. But you should be able to do many things without a calculator. So I encourage you to try them without a calculator. Although technically in applied math, you are allowed to just let that plastic brain do all this stuff for you. So let's plot it and see what it looks like. Oh well, you sort of knew it was going to have that sort of shape, didn't you? Make sure the mode on your calculator is in radians. If you're going to be working in radians, make sure it does that. And if you're on my graphing tool, the graphing TI-83, zoom number 7 trig will almost always make it just a perfect fit. Well, so it makes it like 4 units up, 4 units down, and you know, about 540 degrees to the right and left. So it usually is a nice fit if you use zoom trig, but don't forget to use your zip mode radians. All right, now we're into our periodic functions here. Here's the question. We're going to have to do a regression on this. We'll get the calculator to tell us the formula. Even though I did show you that you can look at that data there and come up with the formula yourself. All right. But you only have to know how to do it with the plastic brain showing you how to do it. But it is possible to calculate the formula without the calculator telling you and be pretty close to. Okay, let's see how this question works when we do the regression on the data. So there's the data there. Let's put in list 1 our time, and let's put in list 2 on our calculator the height, and do the regression. All right, so that's all that stat edit, enter your lists, all that good stuff, second trace, calculate. Oh, not second trace, it's going to be stat, calculate. And I think it's number 0 sinusoidal regression. Right, so there's what it looks like. So your amplitude is 25.7. You can calculate your period, because whatever that b is in front of the x, that number in front of the x, you divide that into 2 pi, so that works out to 32 seconds. How many revolutions does this thing do in 2 minutes? Well, it takes 32 seconds to do one revolution. So 120 seconds will give you ? revolutions. See at the top there? If 32 gets you 1, then 120 gets you what? It's like making muffins. If it's 32 raisins for 1 muffin, then 120 raisins will get you how many muffins? So you could say that this thing went through in 2 minutes. It went through, well, here comes the answer, 3.75 revolutions. It's a pretty fast Ferris wheel. You know what? I wouldn't want to be on that one. Here's another one to graph. Notice it's all in radians. Nowhere in the formula do you see a degree sign. If you don't see a degree sign, everything's in radians. So what is the maximum, the minimum, the amplitude, the period, the median? Well, just looking at the equation, we weren't even going to graph it. But the... Oh no, it said sketch it, didn't it? All right, so we were going to sketch it. So there's the median. The median is the average, the thing that it bounces around. It bounces around 0.5, half in other words. And how much does it bounce? So I drew in the median dotted line. Well, it bounces 0.66 above 0.5. So that sounds like about 1.16 as a maximum height. and then it bounces 0.66 below that 1/2. So it sounds to me, let's see, do a little complicated math there, that'd be negative 0.16 below the x-axis. So we know it bounces between negative 0.16 and 1.166. And we can draw in the start point there, because we know it starts at 1, comma 0.5. And we also know that it's, at 1 comma 0.5. Yeah. And we also know that it's, what's it doing now? Oh, and it's got a period of 3.14, which is pi. So you can just squiggle that in there and you're good to go. Here's another one. Did I mess up that last one? I'll have to go back. Look. There's another equation. Remember, the A is your amplitude, and the B is your, that shows you the period. It relates to the frequency. And the C is like a phase shift. It moves it left and right. C's not all that important, usually. And the D is how far up and down you are, as on average. All right. So that's what they had done in this question. They gave you the picture, and they asked you for the A, the B, the C, and the D. So you can see that the average was obviously about negative 2. You can see that it swung 2 above that and 2 below that, because it had a max of 0 and a min of negative 4, so its average in between must have been negative 2. And the B you could calculate, because it looked like it took about 6 tick marks to complete one whole cycle on the diagram. So 6 goes into 2 pi 1.05 times. Okay, so this was on our practice test too. So if it has a max at 34, a maximum height of water, and a min at 8, well, that automatically tells you where the middle is, because halfway in between 34 and 8, what's an average between 34 and 8? Well, how do you find averages? Add the two numbers together, divided by 2. So it's 42 divided by 2. So the average is 21. So that's the D in the formula. Now let's graph it here. So if it reaches a peak at 7 in the morning. Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, it reaches the peak at 7 a.m. And it reaches its min at 1300. So you got to know how to do 1300. So 6 hours later, it reaches its minimum. Well, guess what? It's going to be back, because of symmetry, another 6 hours after that. So it'll be a 12-hour period, so it'll be back to its peak at 7 p.m. Well, 2100 hours, I prefer to say. So I sort of drew it in there. So sketch the height of the tide versus time for 24-hour period. We've done that. And a lot of it's due to symmetry. Okay. And you could actually come up with the formula if you wanted. Obviously, the D is going to be, what we say, 21. And the amplitude's going to be, what's that going to be, 13? And the, let's see, I don't usually bother with the C because that's not important, the phase shift. And the D, well, yeah, we already did the D. So we did the A. Oh, and the period, we should do the period. Well, we've already said the period of this is 12. How many times does 12 go into 2 pi? And that'll tell you what the B is in the formula. But that wasn't the question. They just wanted us to graph this and be a little bit accurate about it.